Well, hello and welcome to the kitchen table. As you can see, I'm not actually at my kitchen table today. Apologies for that, but my goodness me, we have some of the usual suspects with us. We've got Steve Jones with us from Kitchen Table Shakedown. Steve, good morning to you, because it's morning this time.
Good morning, Colin.
Good to have you along, Steve. And once again, from Autosport Magazine, we have David Evans with us, and he is actually in his kitchen this time. Lovely to see your kitchen, David.
Thank you, Colin. Thank you.
Brief as always, David. That's great. But most importantly, our very, very special guest, one of motorsport's biggest figures. I've just read his CV and it's astonishing. To be fair, first time I've read his CV. He's been with Sauber in Formula One. He's been with Volkswagen, as we all know, with Ford, with Porsche. Really a man who is absolutely immersed in the world of motorsport. It is, for most of you rally fans out there, the former Volkswagen boss. It's Jost Capito. Jost, it's an absolute pleasure to have you along at Kitchen Table Shakedown this morning.
Hey, good morning. Thanks to you all, and it's a pleasure to join you at the kitchen table.
Oh, lovely to see you again. I can't tell you, Jost, how much we genuinely have missed you in rallying. It was always an absolute pleasure to talk with you and to get your views. But I suppose a lot of people will want to know, Jost, what you're up to these days. You left a very healthy situation in Volkswagen. What are you up to? You're still in motorsport, we take it.
Yeah, in the moment, you know, I left Volkswagen to become the CEO of McLaren Racing, as I've always been a McLaren fan, and to getting this opportunity, I could not say no. And everybody at Volkswagen understood that this is a boy's dream coming true. And so I left on very good terms, and that was a fantastic time at Volkswagen. And I had good times at all the companies you mentioned before, but the WRC with Volkswagen was something really outstanding, and living a dream with the whole team. And there was nothing wrong, it was just a challenge for McLaren. But then when Ron Dennis left, I couldn't agree the way forward with the other shareholders and the guys who are running are in charge now. And then we agreed that it's better that I leave, because I wanted the team going in a different direction, and that didn't happen. So now I'm looking for a new challenge, and I think I'm pretty close that something could be announced.
Oh, Jost, what can you tell us a little more about that? Is it in motorsport, I take it, but is it Formula One? Is it rallying? Where might the new challenge be for you?
No, I can't say anything yet, okay. But you can wait a couple of weeks, I think.
Okay, well, we'll very much look forward to that. But let's talk, Jost, about the WRC. When you left things, Volkswagen were very much dominating. I seem to remember we were going to, I think, Argentina last year, and it looked as if Volkswagen were going to win, if you like, a whole year of rallies in a row. That didn't happen because Paddon won. But you left things in a state of domination, I suppose. But it's changed with this new formula. What do you make of the way that the new formula has really revitalized the WRC?
Yeah, I think the WRC is really, really exciting this year. When you see the first four rallies, all four manufacturers won a rally and four different drivers. And I read somewhere it's more than 20 years ago that this happened. So the new formula, I think we can see it's exactly right, and the good cooperation that all the manufacturers we had with the manufacturers, with the FIA, with the promoter, with the journalists as well. You know, you remember we had discussions with you about the new regulation and how where rally should go. I think this unity on all the various stakeholders in WRC, they came up with the perfect solution for the regulations and the new format, and this is shown by the first four rallies.
Yeah, it's really interesting the way that things have turned around, because when you were at Volkswagen, we were looking at new ways of, if you like, making WRC a bit more interesting. And everyone knows about the shootout proposal. Now, I was a big fan of that, and I absolutely supported that. It was something that you were firmly behind. Have you changed your mind on that now, seeing that rallying can be exciting and dramatic without having to introduce really, you know, if you like, far out changes to the formula?
No, I didn't change my mind on this. I think this is the situation because everybody has a new car and then everybody is shaked up. But when you see the gaps still were there, it is not that the rallies were decided on the last stage or even on the last day, and they were more decided by by technical failures, by mistakes of the drivers. They were not. Not common situations. And I think rally could still improve with a different system.
Yeah, you know, I'm totally in agreement with you on that. I think that we continually need to look at new ideas, and I don't think we should be afraid to see rally evolving. Jost, every other sport, maybe apart from football, has evolved. Tennis has evolved, cricket has evolved, golf has evolved, and rallying has to evolve. And I suppose, you know, we do have a lot of people that are very, very traditionally based in rallying, and they can be very difficult to persuade that there is a new and better way.
Yeah, I think nobody from the fans or the public should be worried that rally would go in the wrong direction if changes would be agreed by the stakeholders, because all the stakeholders are long in rally. They are not new. They know what rally is about. They know the spirit of rally, and they would not do anything that would change the spirit of rally. So I think the fans should really trust the stakeholders, as the stakeholders also take the WRC very serious and treat it. It's their baby, and they treat it very carefully. And I think they would not do any changes that would not be agreed by everybody and would change the spirit of rallying. Even if there would be a trial to try a different format for one rally or the other and then see what the outcome is, I think as the rally community works so well together, that would not be a risk for rally at all, whatever they would come up with.
I totally agree with you. David, have you got a thought on that?
Jump in there, Colin.
Go ahead.
Just to say, Jost, that almost sounded like a manifesto. I wonder if would you ever be tempted to move into the governance of motorsport, into rallying specifically?
You know, it depends on what opportunities would come up. In general, my view is the motorsport gave me in my life so much. And I'm motorsport all my life, and cars and motorbikes all my life. And I got so much in my life from motorsport, knowing people, getting friends around the world, getting great experiences. I would be more than happy to give something back. And that's what I tried all my time when I worked in motorsport, but also in the governance, I would be very happy to give some of that experience back to motorsport to make motorsport better.
Do you think, Jost, that the governance of rallying in particular right now is going in the right direction? Because it was very obvious in the past that it was at times almost dictatorial. You talked a lot a couple of minutes ago about everyone coming together, and that clearly is the way forward. But in the past, it has been a bit dictatorial. It has been a bit them and us. Do you feel that there's a change now, in that it is more inclusive, and that decisions are made not unilaterally, but decisions are made by all the stakeholders?
I think the last 4 years when I was at Volkswagen, that was not dictatorial. It was a very good cooperation with all the stakeholders. Finally, somebody has to take the decision, and this is the FIA who has to take the decision, because it's their responsibility. The regulation and rules are not the task of the manufacturers or the teams. It is a responsibility of the FIA. And this is what the manufacturers and the teams have to respect. We can discuss proposals, we can discuss new formats, but finally, it's a responsibility of the FIA. And the decision of the FIA has to be respected by the teams and by the manufacturers. As when the FIA decided against this new format, we also, everybody fully accepted it, even if we would have seen the new format coming through. But we accepted the decision of the FIA and did our very best to make the format as good as possible. And I think that is the spirit that is very unique in WRC.
Jost, regulators, David, 1 second, sorry. Jost, regulators are enormously important, as we know. Perhaps the most important aspect of any sport next to the regulator is the media output, and in particular the TV output. Now, we know in the past there have been one or two issues. It does look as if the TV output in WRC has moved on. From my point of view, I'm enjoying the programs that we're seeing coming out from this season and perhaps the last half of last season. What do you think about the TV coverage? Is it getting there? Is there still a way to go? Or are we more or less where we should be at?
I think the job the new promoter has done in the recent years since he got established is fantastic. Yeah, it's I'm in the UK now, and I enjoy the programs of WRC in the UK, and I can watch it on Red Bull TV, and it's free on air, and it's absolutely outstanding program. I think the program itself improved a lot, and the broadcasters improved a lot. So when you compare it to 3-4 years ago to now, there is a huge difference that I think nobody at that time would have ever dreamed of.
Absolutely. David, you had a point to make.
I wanted to go back to Portugal a few years ago, Jost, when I accept now that we are perhaps more community-minded as a whole, but there were some tricky times, and it was you and the manufacturers that really sorted that out in Portugal when drivers went on strike and refused to speak to the WRC TV crews. But we kind of needed that, didn't we? We needed to force the hand a little bit to bring people together.
Yeah, I think this is always the case, isn't it? It is a professional sport, and there are various interests, and the interests are not all the same, but what WRC achieved in bringing all these together, and the example you just told, it really shows how the WRC community organization can solve also tricky situations. Yeah, and also shows that the drivers have a view, they have a voice, and they can take decisions. And there's a good cooperation with the teams, with the drivers, and not only the teams with their drivers. Yeah, everybody can talk to everybody, and it makes WRC as well unique. And the short time I've been now again in Formula One, it's in Formula One, it is not the case.
Oh, that's interesting. Jost, let's move on because I know your time's limited this morning. Ford and M Sport are doing a remarkable job. They lead the Drivers' Championship. They lead the Manufacturers' Championship. You know, cut your arm, Jost, and you still bleed Ford. I'm sure of that. You know, you're great days and a lot of your hard work in rallying went into your time at Ford. What do you make of the situation there? You know, we saw Dave Perisic in Monte Carlo. His first ever rally, would you believe? But the best one. They won Monte Carlo. Tanak, with a brilliant drive, came in third. Can you see the situation, perhaps, Jost, where Ford get involved again as a full-time manufacturer? Or are they just saying, look, why should we? We're getting all this for nothing.
You know, I know Dave Perisic is a very good friend of mine because when I worked in the US for Ford, I was in charge of the Mustang Shelby GT500 program, and he was chief engineer of the Mustang. So we worked together on a daily basis, and we exchanged a lot on motorsport, on performance vehicles, and we became really good friends, and I'm still in contact with him. And we talk about what you just talked about. And, you know, of course, I'm still a fan of Ford on WRC. We had a great time with Markham, and Markham deserves a success. And also, I don't want to say a special driver, but, you know, Sepp is an outstanding driver. And I think he is the best of the world in the world right now.
Well, I think he is. But you've avoided the question quite nicely there, Jost, and that's your prerogative. Do you think Ford are considering and will see the value in a full-time return to the WRC?
I'm sure they see the value, especially with the situation they're in now, having Sepp as a driver. I'm sure they see the value. But, you know, in these big companies, they take their decisions carefully. And that Dave has been at the rally, and I know he visited M Sport as well. I think this is a very good sign, and you know, you get the virus of rally when you have been at a rally, not before. Okay. So let's hope that the virus is implemented in him, and he will go ahead with this.
Well, I'm sure you're being a fantastic ambassador there, Steve. You're sitting patiently. You've got a question, no?
Yes, I have. I've got a question for Jost, and I think given that Jost has worked at the very highest levels at both F1 and in WRC. I'd just like to ask him about basically how F1 is reported in the media. Much is made of driver and team rivalries. I mean, if we look at Lewis Hamilton and Nico Rosberg, and more recently, Fernando Alonso wants to go and drive in Indy 500, and there's been criticism of some of the drivers. And F1's new owners, Liberty Media, have explicitly said that they want to promote and even capitalize upon rivalries between teams and drivers. Do you think that WRC should go maybe a bit down that road, or do you think that the absence of that kind of confrontation is a strength of WRC? What's your opinion, Ross? Do you think that we should go down that road?
I think you need rivalry in any sport, because sport is defined by rivalry. Mm-hmm. And you have this in WRC. But there are different kinds of rivalry. There are friendly rivalries and there are hostile rivalries. And I don't think that WRC needs hostile rivalries. And the nature of the sport of rallying is completely different than Formula One. The drivers are together all day, you know, they wait together before a stage, they talk together, they exchange information, and they still fight very hard and they want to win, but they respect each other very much. And this is the nature of the sport, because they share so much time together. And there are two guys in the car, so it's a complete, it's much more team sport than Formula One is when the cars are out there. Now, Formula One is a big top team sport as well, because it's like if you look at the whole team, everything has to work perfect to be successful. But when it really counts and the drivers are out there and do their job, it's a different way. And it's always different if you are at the same time on the same track. It's a different rivalry, or if you just fight against the time on your own.
Hmm. Yeah, but do you think maybe, Jost? I think there's a place. I think great champions have a ruthless streak in them, and it doesn't really matter which sport we're talking about. They really do. They have a determined, ruthless streak. Do you think one or two drivers in rallying perhaps have suffered because the nature of rallying doesn't promote that ruthless streak? And I'm perhaps talking about Jari Matti Latvala in particular here.
I know. If you talk about Seb, I tell you he has the ruthless streak. There is no doubt about it.
Exactly.
And that's what makes him really the top. For him, is winning or nothing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Jari Matti has a great talent. And I think in Formula One, it would be would be different for the two. Yeah, I think Seb would succeed in Formula One with his character, and Jari Matti would not. Mm-hmm. But in rallying, where you drive really against the time, there it doesn't matter so much. So there, even a nice guy can be successful in WRC.
Yeah, and there's plenty of nice guys, we know that. Let's talk a little bit more, if you don't mind, Jost, if you've got a bit of time. Just you let us know, Jost, because we're going to use and abuse you this morning as much as we can.
I know you, so I took a lot of time off talking to you.
Yeah, that's just for my questions. Let's talk a bit about Jari Matti, Jost, because a bit of a revelation. Do you feel that in your 4 years at Volkswagen, perhaps you didn't get the best out of Jari Matti, or perhaps you feel that you prepared Jari Matti for what we're seeing now? Which way do you look at it?
It's difficult. That's a very difficult question. I think we got the best out of Jari Matti when he really was at his best. And he is very talented. But you know, it is in every team, it is the main guy you have to beat is your teammate. Because they are in the same team, they have the same machinery, they have everything the same. So you have to beat, first of all, your teammate. And if you are in the team with Seb, it is not easy. And the same it was for Seb. For Seb, it was hard to beat Jari Matti. So I think for Seb, it doesn't matter who is his teammate. For Jari Matti, I think it is important who is a teammate. If he beats his teammate, I think he can develop and go from strength to strength and can beat everybody else. But if he has this direct competition within the team, I think that is a difficult situation for him.
So with that in mind, you would not necessarily be advising Mr. Mäkinen to hire Andreas Mikkelsen, because that might actually take away from this revitalized Latvala that we're seeing.
If I would be a team principal, the one guy I would want is Andreas. That's it, full stop.
but he can't work with Latvala, is what you're saying as well. Or you won't get the best out of Latvala if you put Andreas in that team.
I don't know. It wouldn't say you can't get the best. And I think Jari Matti would see Andreas in a different way than he sees Seb. But I agree, it would make the situation for Jari Matti more difficult. I'm sure it would.
How surprised were you to see the situation developing at the end of last year with Mikkelsen not having a drive for this year, having driven the rally of his life in Australia, sorry. How surprised were you to see the situation developing?
I was surprised that he didn't get the seat. On the other hand, I would have been surprised if Seb or Jari wouldn't have got the seat. Yeah, and it was the decision of Volkswagen was quite late in the season, so I also respect the situation or the view of the team principals that they stick to the contracts they had and do not just sack one driver to get another driver in. That also shows the spirit of WRC and of rallying, that you stick to your commitments. So it was not easy, but I'm sure Andreas will find a drive. He's still very young, and I think this situation he's in right now will strengthen him even more.
David?
Jost, just a quick one, Jost. Would you have, in Toyota's position, would you have gone with Jari Mäty or would you have gone with Andreas last year?
It's difficult to say because, you have to be in Tommy's shoes to know what all the conditions are. And it's for me, it's impossible to say. I'm sure he's very clever. He's in the rallying in the sport for much longer, maybe 10 times longer than I am. So I'm sure he took the right decision.
Steve?
Yeah, just one last question for me, Colin, really is. Yesterday, it was announced that Raymond Baumschlager had taken possession of Apollo RWRC, the one that Sebastian Ogier drove last year. How does that make you feel, Jost? Does it make you feel sentimental that your baby has now flown the nest?
I don't know if he bought it or it just get a drive. I don't know the details. I was just seeing the note that he is going to drive.
Yeah.
And I value Raimund very highly, and I'm really happy for him that he gets the chance.
And you're happy to see the car put to good use, as it were.
Of course, I'm happy to see the car out with the right guys, and Raimund definitely is the right guy to get a drive in the Polo WRC. That's for sure. I'm really happy for him.
Yeah,
I would love to be there and see it, so, but I can't.
David,
I wonder of total domination of the World Championship. This may seem like a stupid question. I apologise if it is. Do you feel there is any unfinished business in WRC for you?
No. If there would have been unfinished business, I wouldn't have left. So, even last year, I stayed at Volkswagen until it was pretty sure that Volkswagen would secure the championship. And not seeing that there is not unfinished business doesn't mean that I don't miss it. Yeah,
right.
I really miss it.
And
I follow the rallies and I follow them live and whenever I can. And I'm in touch with the guys. I'm still in touch with all the six guys, all the three drivers, the three co-pilots. We're in touch before the rally, during the rally, after the rally. And we even have a group WhatsApp chat where we exchange our experience together so that everybody knows that the others hear it as well. It's still like a team chat. So it's really good fun.
Yeah, go on, David. David?
Sorry, Colin. Just on the back of that, then, do you have any regrets at leaving Volkswagen, Jost, with the benefit of hindsight, the way everything's panned out for you with McLaren? You know,
No, I don't have regrets. I think if I wouldn't have done it, I would regret not having taken the opportunity. And not everything works always out as it works out. But this is behind me, and I'm looking forward. And I'm in discussion with absolutely fantastic opportunities. And it made me stronger. The situation and the experience made me stronger, and I would not want to miss that in my life.
Yeah. Jost, listen, it's absolutely no surprise that you're in discussions because you're a success. Everything you seem to do is a success. I heard from friends who work at McLaren that in the very short period you were there, things were beginning to turn around and were beginning to look good. So no surprise whatsoever that a man of your caliber is in demand. An absolute pleasure talking with you this morning. We'd love to catch up with you again at some point during the year, if that's okay, Jost, if you're not too busy.
No, absolutely, and it's always a pleasure to talk to you. And as much as I miss the rallies, I miss talking to the three of you as well. So that is always a very pleasant and very nice part of being in WRC.
Oh, you say the best things, Jost. You really do.
No. And I think that also that WRC is improving and is so good. That is, it's really because you guys do an outstanding and fantastic job. And this is also with give my regards to Bex, because I listen to the World Rally Radio every rally from morning to night.
Oh dear! Well, that puts pressure on me.
And it's also you play good music in there as well. I like the music, not just you talking.
Jost, thank you very, very much indeed for your time this morning from almost your kitchen table in that lovely spot overlooking the Thames. Jost, thank you very much. You can press the big red button now, Jost Capito. Thank you.
I don't see a big red button here.
Go to the top of your screen.
I have no idea. But
oh, hang on. I'll get with you then.
Have a great rally in Argentina, yeah? And all the very best.
Thank you, Jost.
My regards to everybody.
Certainly will, Jost Capito. Thank you very much indeed.
Thanks, guys.
Right. Now, Roy, if you can just hang up somehow, Jost, I'm not really sure how you do it.
Fine, no problem.
Because we're going to talk about you. So we don't want to hear what we're talking about you.
Okay, I listen.
he's great. He's not going to go now. Oh, no. I was going to say such lovely things as well. Let me get rid of you, Jost.
Okay. Enjoy, guys, yeah?
Thanks, Jost. All the best.
And you can give me information from the rally or if something. We can stay in touch through these weekends. I really enjoy that.
Well, I tell you what we might
I tell you, the group WhatsApp chat with the guys, with me, is absolutely fantastic. When I say, look, you have to fulfill the business, you have to win this rally. I don't care who, but one of you has to. And then one guy says, okay, I'll do it. I'll do my best. And the other guy says, fuck off, I'll do it.
Well, I tell you what, Jost, I have an idea.
Huh?
Why don't you, Jost, include us in that WhatsApp chat?
No.
That would be interesting. Guys, I am now, I have worked out.
You, I can't imagine. So I hang up so that you can talk about me, okay?
Jost, I am going to press the eject button. Jost Capito, you are off. Bye-bye.
Bye, guys. Bye.
Bye. There we go. He's gone. I worked out how to get rid of him. Listen, you know, David, I don't know about you, but I always love talking to Jost. He is such an open and honest character. It's a delight. And a man with such enormous experience.
Yeah, you're absolutely right, Colin. And you know, he did some great things for the sport, for the championship. He turned around that situation, particularly in Portugal that year. Teams, he brought them together, and we have a lot to thank him for.
I think we do. And he was a little cryptic in talking about the future. I'd love to see him back in rallying. I don't think that's going to happen. I thought when you mentioned governance there, I thought maybe, goodness me, David Evans is onto something, but I don't think that's the case either. I think he's doing something else somewhere else in motorsport, which is a shame for rallying.
But it's, I mean, this is the point with someone like Jost, you know, his experience is so wide-ranging, you know, from, like you said, the Porsche side of things, all the way through Formula One, you know, there's bikes, there's endurance, there's Dakar, there's everything, you know, and he could go absolutely anywhere. And for me, you know, it would be great to see him in governance, because, you know, he is, as we saw with that idea of the shootout on the final day, you know, he has some brilliant ideas. I'm not saying they're absolutely right for the sport, but he has some ideas, and, you know, that's what we need. That's what a sport thrives on.
I think Colin said many times in the past, certainly in interviews I've heard with Colin's made with Jost. I mean, fundamentally, Jost Capito is a rally fan. He genuinely is, you know. He has a real passion for the sport, and he doesn't just look at our sport from, say, a team manager perspective. He looks at it from a fan perspective as well.
Do you know, that was one thing that Volkswagen did just about everything right when they were in the World Rally Championship. But one thing, and I picked this up with their PR guys, I don't think they gave Jost, the PR team at Volkswagen, enough support when he was proposing this shootout. A lot of people got it completely wrong. A lot of people took it from the wrong point of view, interpreted it wrongly. And Jost took a lot of flack because of it. You're right, Steve. You know, people don't realize that he's not a selfish man. He wasn't talking in those days purely from a Volkswagen perspective. He was talking from a rallying perspective because he has and always will have the best interests of rallying at heart. And it was the only thing that I think in the 4 years that Volkswagen were in the championship that I actually thought, guys, you're not doing a great job here. You didn't give the boss enough support in that regard.
But maybe that's why they didn't, because what Jost was saying was not Volkswagen's position, it was Jost Capito's position. And maybe that's why they were a bit reluctant to kind of wade in behind him, if you like.
But in many ways, exactly, it's a bit of a fine line there, isn't it? When Jost Capito is the motorsport director, you know, Jost Capito is Volkswagen Motorsport in WRC. And there's some parts I agree with what Colin said there, that, you know, I think he was not misrepresented, but it certainly didn't come across as well as it could have done. Mm. You know, perhaps, you know, we're quite a traditionalist sport, and it was perhaps too radical for that. But then equally, you take that a bit further, and, you know, the probably the most conservative sport is cricket.
Mm-hmm.
To move to one day matches and then ultimately to 2020, which is bastardization of the original test match. But it works. It works tremendously well. And there's room for both of those elements in the sport of cricket. And sometimes I feel that we're too quick to protect what we've got and what we've had and be revolutionary and really risk a little bit and get out there.
Well, as one old boss of mine used to say, Colin, 2 ears, one mouth. Very good reason. Listen. And we don't listen. We talk an awful lot, and sometimes we just don't listen. And sometimes we don't want to listen. We don't want to hear. But we can certainly talk in this sport, and there's a lot of people around who can talk. But Jost Capito, Superman, and again, many, many, many thanks to Jost for giving up his time and going to some efforts to make sure that you could see him this morning. I have to say, wasn't the easiest of tasks to get Jost set up from his lovely apartment there on the Thames. But let's move on, boys, because we've already taken quite a lot of time this morning. Let's talk Rally Argentina, because, David, you're off tomorrow. I'm off this afternoon. It's an interesting one for me, David. Very, very difficult to pick the winner. Conditions out there look interesting. Same stages as last year. Difficult to pick the winner. What do you think?
You're exactly right there, Colin. It's very, very difficult. And, you know, you'd look at it, it's a gravel rally. From what I can understand, the weather's going to be
fantastic.
Mid-20s and sunshine, mm-hmm. A bit of rain perhaps in the run-up to it. So will it clean? And do we rule out the guys at the front? And I have to say that I don't think we do. I've been researching here, Colin, on your behalf. And if you look at the...
What are you trying to say? Go ahead. So say that again.
On the first day, on Friday, we have three stages run mm-hmm. twice. And all but one of those, or so, one of those is new. Those two stages that we used last year, similar conditions.
Mm.
At the end of Friday, Ogier was 10.8 seconds off the lead.
Mm-hmm.
So therefore, we've got the same conditions. The only thing that we don't know this year is how much they've graded the roads over the winter. If they've done a lot of work on the roads, quite possibly it will be quite loose. But if we go there with similar conditions to those same roads, we'll be in the fight for this one.
Yeah, it looks as if everyone's in with a shout. You've got to say, looking at the start list, looking at traditionally what we'd expect from a gravel rally, you're the two guys who we will be watching very, very closely, particularly on day one, will be Paddon and Chris Meek, both of whom have won the event previously. But I was going to say both of whom are struggling. Clearly, Chris Meek isn't struggling. He's right back up on a high. But off those drivers, it is Paddon that needs the result. But those boys have to make the most. If there is an opportunity, and it might only be a small one, Steve, they have to make the most on Friday morning to give themselves something to defend going into Saturday and Sunday.
Absolutely. If I could just say that I'm the odd one out. I won't be going to Argentina. I'll be spending my weekend in Carlisle, the Pirelli International Rally up there, the second round of the British Rally Championship. So, but I'll be with you in spirit, guys, I can assure you.
Very
yeah,
good.
David mentioned Sebastian Ogier. Sebastian Ogier has never won this rally, which is quite extraordinary.
Is it the only one that he hasn't won, Steve?
I think it is, yes. I think it pretty well is. Yeah, he's never won this. Juho Hannanen won it in IRC.
2010, I was there. I remember that. It was a great victory.
Yeah, but Sebastian hasn't won it. So, I think he could do well this weekend. You mentioned Hayden Paddon. Hayden, what a year Hayden's had, you know. It's been quite incredible, really. I mean, so unfortunate what happened in Monte Carlo. And when they got to Mexico, there was the issue of the fuel filters that affected all three cars. But, you know, he'll be back. And undoubtedly, you know, we know what he can do in terms of WRC, win events, and he can set some blistering times when he's on top of his game. You know, how many times have we left kind of gobsmacked at times that Hayden Paddon has set on some stages? And last year, fourth in the championship with 12 stage wins, you know, he'll be back. He'll be back for sure.
Well, I'm sure he will, but he needs to get back now, and he needs to get back into it. And we will hear from Hayden Paddon, by the way, very, very shortly at the end of this little discussion. I did an interview with Hayden, actually, just before he left for Argentina. So we'll hear that coming up very shortly. But the one thing that always stands out in Argentina, David, is attrition. You know, we've seen our drivers, Konrad Rautenbach, got his best ever result in Argentina. I think he was fifth. Matthew Wilson had a fourth. Luis Perez Compank finished fifth or sixth. We often see massive gaps because attrition comes into things. Why is that, David? Why is it such an atrocious rally Argentina?
Well, a lot of that is to do, firstly, with the surface. It's a much sandier, much softer surface than a lot of the European gravel rallies. And also to do with the weather. You know, that you mentioned Konrad Rautenbach. That year, we wouldn't forget the horrendous rain and the fog. When you have a lot of rain, it really churns the surface up. It makes it muddy. But just so that's the reason for me that it is those conditions, the combination of the surface and the weather, the difficult weather, because don't forget it's autumn when we get there. But the thing that I would say as well about the running order is it's a very fine line, perfect surface, because what you have is particularly the stages on the weekend, the stages around Coscan to the west of Carlos Paz, that sandy surface. And once that surface is broken, it begins to dig in very quickly. Mm-hmm. And that's where the trouble comes, is once you dig out those rocks, car 7, 8, 9 on the road, you could actually have a worse surface line, and it's harder to drive. Looking at an optimum place of around 3, 4, 5 on the road, where you've taken the loose sand, because there's not a lot of loose on the top. Mm-hmm. That line, a good line, lots of grip. Then are we looking at Thierry Neuville again?
Well, yeah, but here's the thing, guys, and this is what always struck me about Sebastian Loeb in Argentina. Loeb was, for me, one of the cleverest drivers that we've seen over the past 20 or 30 years, and his notes were unbelievably detailed. And what he could do is he could pick out the corners where the sand would dig, and he could pick out what looked like a bit like an iceberg that sank the Titanic. All you're seeing is the tip of a stone. It looks like a small rock, but in fact, that's the tip of a monstrous embedded rock. And Loeb knew on certain corners that rock will dig out. And by the time I get here for the second pass, that is a suspension-breaking rock. And he would note those things. So it requires, I think, a hugely focused and concentrated reconnaissance, Steve, really to give you the ammunition you need to deal with, as David said, conditions that once the sand is gone, you know, it's like a moonscape in places with a huge, not like a moonscape, like a dried riverbed in places with the amount of embedded rock, the amount of enormous boulders that appear in the stage.
Well, and of course, Sebastian Loeb was the master of changing notes for the second run, wasn't he? I mean, he and Daniel Ellerton would almost have a conversation on the first run about note adjustment for the second run. But maybe, you know, what David just mentioned there, does that belie the fact that Sebastian Ogier has not won the rally, and he'd been first on the road for the past 4 years, has he?
Three or four years at least.
In the Volkswagen. Yeah. So, you know, is that the reason why Sebastian Ogier's never won it?
Well, potentially. He's been there a lot of times in the past, but yeah, you're quite right. In the Volkswagen, he was more or less always first on the road, and for 2 days, remember, for the last few years, certainly with Volkswagen. One day this year, I think he's got a chance, but I think Ogier's approach is completely different this year. Ogier will be making sure he gets the finish. If he doesn't win it, he wants to be in second place. He wants to be in a position to score 5 points, 4 or 5 points in the power stage. Ogier has got a different approach to things this year. So I won't be betting on Ogier, oddly, on this one. I really won't. We'll wrap up.
But also, Colin,
go on.
Just to counterbalance that a little bit, Ogier, as we've already discussed here, is the most super competitive driver in the whole championship. And he does not like the fact that there's one event that's missing from his full repertoire of winning everywhere. And absolutely, I agree. You know, he's going for a consistent approach this year. But equally, if there's one event he probably wants to win, he's never stood on top of the podium there.
Yeah, no, that's very, very true indeed. Boys, I'm going to ask you for 1-2-3s. I am going to go with Meek Paddon Ogier on this one. Steve, what's your 1-2-3?
Ogier.
Ooh.
Meek. Latvala.
Ooh, I think that's a bit of a ballsy one with Latvala, but let's see. We'll make a note of that. David Evans from Autosport Magazine, your 1-2-3?
News. I'm going for Chris Meek winning, Sebastian Ogier second, and Craig Breen third.
That's another ballsy one. Yeah, Craig Breen, you know, what a start to the year he's had. We haven't touched on Craig Breen at all, really. Guys, fantastic. A great discussion again. News, any last bits of news? Motorsport News is out on Wednesday. Anything you want to tell us? Any scoops that you've got there, David, you can share with us?
Yeah, absolutely, Colin. As it is every week, it's absolutely packed full of analysis and news about the WRC, but I'm afraid no scoops, so you're going to have to buy it on Wednesday, Colin.
Oh, well, I get it sent to me. I get it through the door. It's great. I don't pay for it. I love that. Yeah, any further little bits, little snippets from you, Stevie, the man with his nose to the ground? Anything that we should know about before we head off to Argentina?
Not a huge amount. I mentioned the Ramon Bamschlager taking possession of the new Polo, which he's going to be driving this coming weekend in the Austrian Rally Championship. But all focus is on Argentina now, and so nothing spectacular coming through at the moment now.
Well, there we go. Okay, guys, what we're going to finish with is this interview that I did. So I will, before we head over to the interview that I did just before he left New Zealand with Hayden Paddon, I will say once again an enormous thank you to from Autosport Magazine and Motorsport News, David Evans. Thank you very much this morning for giving us your time, David.
Thank you, Colin. Pleasure as always.
Safe flight, and I'm looking forward to that glass of wine and that half cow that you're going to buy me out in Argentina.
I thought you were buying that.
Oh, yeah. Oh, geez, these things just slipped my mind far too quickly. Steve Jones back in the rallying UK den in deepest, darkest central Wales. As always, a total pleasure talking to you, Steve. Enjoy Carlisle.
Thank you, Colin, and have a safe trip, guys.
Thank you very much indeed, Steve. And just to let you know, Georgie Donaldson, other commitments this week, but George is an absolute integral part of our Kitchen Table Shakedown show, and he will be back next week, that's for sure. So let's end this show this weekend by hearing, as I said, from Hayden Paddon. And I have to say, he sounds very, very optimistic about his chances this week in Argentina.
Yeah, good evening. Welcome to our kitchen.
Yeah, it looks fabulous. And by the way, we have to start by wishing you a very, very happy birthday, Hayden Paddon. 30 years old. That's quite a milestone, isn't it?
Oh, you do not need to be reminding me of that. I'm trying to forget it.
What I will remind you of is when I first met you. It was Rally New Zealand. When was it? 2008, I think it was, when you first won the New Zealand Rally Championship. You were just a young whippersnapper, 20, 21 years old. Was it nearly 10 years ago?
Yeah, nearly 10 years ago. I've got a lot more grey hair since then, so that's what rallying does to you, isn't it? So, but he's hoping it's a sign of some more maturity and maybe another phase of my life.
Yeah, well, I'm sure it is. Listen, I mean, I have to say, Hayden, I have taken tremendous joy and pleasure in watching your career because I didn't know who you were until Rally New Zealand that year. But you stood out. You stood out a mile as someone full of talent, full of determination, with a real drive to get to the very top. And at the time, I do remember thinking, oh, poor lad. You know, he's on the other side of the world. He's got bob all chance. You know, he might be enormously talented, but my goodness me, it shows that with some determination, you can achieve. If you've got the talent and the determination, you can achieve, but you've worked bloody hard to get where you are.
Oh, it's definitely been a long road. You know, we've obviously talked about it a few times, and people know the struggles that we've gone through to get to where we got to now. And I guess even now, you sometimes got to pinch yourself to go and actually just ask yourself, how did we do it? Because there were so many obstacles and barriers along the way, and it is pretty surreal. But obviously, there's no point getting to where we are now if we actually can't make the most of being here. So that's obviously the next step of it all. But you know, hopefully what we've done will help bring a few other Kiwis through in the future. And the health of rallying in New Zealand right now is the best it's ever been. And there's a lot of good young teenagers down here rallying. So hopefully we'll see more of them up there in the future.
Yeah, well, that's a knock-on effect, clearly, of the efforts that you've put in, isn't it? And I think New Zealand rallying for probably decades to come will see the benefits of the effort and the hard work that you've put in. But let's talk, as you say, about the future, about the now, actually. Let's talk about Rally Argentina, Hayden, because clearly you're going back to Argentina with fantastic memories of last year. But memories don't count for anything unless you can actually repeat that performance this year. It's been a troublesome start to the year for you. How confident do you feel that you can go to Argentina in the right frame of mind and compete for the win there this year?
Yeah, I think what good memories do is it gives you more confidence to go there and be comfortable in the rally and comfortable in yourself and what you can achieve. And the game that we play in is all about confidence. If you're confident, you get the results. We see that with a lot of drivers. So, you know, we just need one or two good results to get back on that train. And, you know, it hasn't been the best of starts to the year. But when you actually really break it down, all the rallies that we've done so far this year, we've never had good results on the past years as well. Mexico, Corsica, okay, Sweden, okay, was the only one where we missed out, but there were some other circumstances that didn't help us there. So I don't think it's all lost. I think we can get things back on track. You know, the next five rallies suit us. Argentina, of course. So, yeah, not all lost. Not all is lost quite yet.
Yeah, and I suppose, you know, there are lots of positives that we can take from the season so far. Clearly, there have been setbacks, but there are lots of positives. And the biggest positive, I think, has to be the car. You know, the success you've achieved in the World Championship in a World Rally car has come while you've been developing, basically, cars. And, you know, the Hyundai in the past, yes, it won a couple of rallies, but it was always, always struggling for development. You know, this is now the third Hyundai World Rally car in, what, 3 or 4 years. But what you have now, this year, on the face of it, is the best car out there. It seems to be the most reliable car out there. That's a fantastic platform to go into any rally with.
Yeah, obviously Terry's been doing a good job. He's proved that the car is very competitive and fast and strong, and I think it's all very close across the board this year as well. But, you know, as a driver, it gives you a lot more confidence when you have a good package and a good team around you, and we certainly have that. But, you know, we're struggling personally at the moment to get the car working for my driving style. The car's working very well for Terry's driving style. But the way I drive the car, the things that I want the car to do is quite different. So, you know, that's a challenge for the engineers and everything when you have essentially one car to do two different jobs. And we've gone through the phase, if you like, of trying to adjust my driving style more in Terry's way, if you like. But we've learned that doesn't work, and I have to keep to my natural style. So we're learning and we're just trying to adapt the car to work better.
You know, we've had two big name guests on our program so far. We started off with Sebastian Ogier and we talked to Mads Osberg last night. And to both of those guests, we talked about this active center diff. Now, Ogier, limited experience of driving a car with active center diff. Mads Osberg, a little bit more. You don't have any experience of driving a World Rally car with an active center diff. Do you think perhaps that's why you're looking for such a different setup from, obviously, Danny Sauda, who's got massive experience of it, and I believe that Neuville's also driven an active center diff before. Is that taking a little bit of working out how to drive the car, but get the best out of the car with that issue? Well, it's not an issue, but with that setup.
Yeah. Yes and no. Like, obviously, it is something else to learn, but it's the combination of everything from the chassis to the center differential and how that's working with the mechanical side of the diffs as well. So, the center diff is key. At the moment, it's probably more a balancing with the chassis where I'm struggling. You know, the car's working well, but it's just, you know, just trying to have some confidence that it's doing what I want it to do. So, but the team are working really hard. They're trying to help me. And, you know, I think we can find some improvements and some step forward into the area that I'm focusing on, hopefully over the next sort of two or three rallies.
So tell us about your preparation then for Argentina. We're watching right now, actually, Danny Sordo testing. Where are they? I think they're in Portugal, aren't they? We're hearing that Mickelson is going to test your car as well. That's quite interesting. When did you do your testing for Argentina, Hayden? Because you are back home in New Zealand just now. When did you do your pre-Argentina test?
Yeah, well, the testing that they're actually doing now is officially a Portugal test that they're doing. We all did our Argentina test before Corsica, so we did 2 days on gravel. So we've got 2 days, the others got one, and then again they get 1 day now. So basically throughout the year, the balance of all our test day works out to be even throughout the year, but just for some of our travel and logistics and getting back to New Zealand to work with our sponsors, which is also important, just means that we juggle them around a little bit. But last year we come home, we did Rally Otago, we spent 5 weeks out of the World Rally Car with no testing, went straight to Argentina, one shakedown, and then obviously we know the result of the rally, so maybe no test before the rally could be the secret answer.
Well, it could be. I think there's always an argument for overthinking, and it does astonish me the number of times that drivers come away from tests with an enormously positive frame of mind, the perfect setup, they're going to compete for the win on the rally, and then by the end of the first stage, they're lost. And I can never quite understand that. But then testing is so, so different from the actual rally and competitive conditions. It's almost impossible in a test to replicate rally competitive conditions.
Yeah, and that's what we are trying to do at the moment. We're trying to think outside the box and how you do replicate rally conditions. You know, it's very difficult in a test. You have a short road. By the time you've done it 3 or 4 times, you know the road, you know where the grip is, you know the braking points. And you adapt, even when you don't want to adapt to it, subconsciously you do adapt to it. And then, of course, that affects everything you're doing with the car setup, how you feel with the car. So, you know, in an ideal world, you'd have maybe 10 or 15 different test roads or different sections in the day, and you just keep changing. But that's obviously not logistically possible.
No, you know, something that I actually thought about in the last rally, we saw all those issues, didn't we, with the cars in Mexico, apart from the Citroens. Long stage, reasonably warm. I'm not going to say it was hot because it was far from hot in Mexico on that stage on Friday afternoon. It was warm, though. And it struck me that none of those World Rally cars had really done anything, probably more than an 8 or 10 kilometer stretch in one go. You know, it's not as if you are doing 30, 40, 50 kilometer test stages. So, you know, these little problems will, I think, continue to emerge as the season goes on, as we encounter different conditions and different stages that the new World Rally cars have never experienced before.
Oh, certainly, and it's one of the challenges for the designers, the engineers who are, you know, putting a lot of work back in at the factory with the computers and the calculations to try and preempt a lot of this stuff. But, you know, it's difficult when Mexico is obviously, it's warmer than what it is in Europe, and, you know, unless you're testing in sort of July, August, the year before in Europe, you can't simply replicate the conditions. So, okay, now we're going into the summer in Europe, so it's a bit easier and the teams are going to be more prepared with every rally that goes on and iron out the little problems.
It is fantastic, though, isn't it, to be part of the championship this year, just as a commentator, as a media person. It is the best year that I've had so far in the championship. But as a driver, how much fun is it to actually be involved in a championship where, once again, we have 6 or 7 or 8 drivers who go into each rally thinking, I could win this if things go my way. It must be so much more satisfying for you as a driver to be involved in this kind of championship.
Oh, certainly, it's exciting, and I can see from a fan's perspective how it's perfect. It's, you know, come on leaps and bounds to what it has been in the future. But personally, I'm only satisfied if we're up near the front as well. If we're down the lower end of that top eight, then, you know, it's not something I can be satisfied with. But yeah, it is close, and it does mean that there is no room for error. Okay, it's always been like that, but even more so this year because the margins are so small, you just can't afford to be giving away time or stages anywhere. So it means drivers are going to be more prepared. We're always trying to find that little bit more all the time, and that continues even again this year. And, you know, things are just going to progressively get faster.
Yeah, but listen, you know, the last 4 years, realistically, no one else was going to win rallies unless Volkswagen had problems. Okay, last year we saw Chris Meek coming in and winning a couple of rallies, which was great to see. But that's all gone. That absolute domination is gone. You know, there isn't one team that dominates anymore. And that, for me, is such a different dynamic. Yes, you have to, as you rightly say, you'll make sure you don't make any mistakes. But, you know, there's no domination in the championship. That's such a healthy position.
Yeah, it is. It's what the sport needs. It's what creates interest for fans. It's what's going to bring in new fans. Obviously, with different manufacturers winning as well, it just creates, you know, so much interest in the sport. So, you know, we just need to keep this going. It's great that we've got this year. It's year one. It's new. It's exciting. But, you know, you can't let things carry on and become stale. So, you know, it's got to be progressively worked on. And you know, year two, year three will be the most important part of this sort of new era of the WRC.
Yeah, listen, I have to tell you something, Hayden Paddon. I'm looking at you there, and you are obviously looking fabulous, healthier, fitter, more handsome than you've ever looked. But what's astonishing is in the Paddon kitchen that you're sitting in, there's a streak of light, and it's almost biblical. It's almost godlike. It's like you're being touched by something, by something, you know, otherworldly. I think that's a good sign. I think I'm going to have a bet on you. Oh, there you are. It's there. It's there for you to harness and to grab hold of. I'm off to Matt Osberg's betting site to have a bet on you now, I tell you. You're looking good to me.
I know. I'm feeling good for Argentina, to be honest. So I must admit, every time we come back home to New Zealand, it's sort of like a new lease of life. Even though it's on the other side of the world, it's just always more comfortable coming home. And if I had it my own way, you know, I'd come home between each event. But, you know, 30 hours on a plane is just a bit too much sometimes.
Well, it's not just that, is it? It's the jet lag. It's the jet lag afterwards. It's the 3 or 4 days that it takes you to get used to the new time zone. How do you cope with that? Are you getting more used to it, or is it still as difficult as ever?
Yes and no. Like, to be honest, I don't fight it anymore, because the one thing I like about jet lag is it means I've become a morning person. And when I get into a time zone, I'm the worst morning person ever. I'm grumpy and I don't like getting out of bed. When I got jet lag, 4 o'clock in the morning, bang. At it, and you're doing stuff, and you feel quite productive. So, yeah, no, I don't really fight it, but yeah.
Well, what I want to see on your Instagram, Hayden Paddon, is more pictures of those glorious New Zealand sunrises at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock in the morning.
There's no shortage of them here. You just got to come spend more time in New Zealand yourself.
Yeah, I'm coming. I'm missing it. It's far too many years
for a holiday.
Yeah, I'm actually, No, I can do that. I want to come out to a rally. I think, you know, we're missing the rally in New Zealand. I saw some great pictures. What was the rally recently? Was it Whangarei? Is that coming? Otago, that's it.
That's right.
And the roads, my goodness me, the roads. It doesn't really matter where you go in New Zealand. You get fabulous rally roads. And it was just so wonderfully evocative of those great days of the World Rally Championship. And listen, I know it's late, and I know we've kept you for probably longer than we should have. But one last question, seeing as we've gone down this direction. Rally New Zealand, what's the latest, Hayden? You've got your finger on the pulse in terms of where the organisers are at. Can we expect to be coming back to New Zealand soon?
From a personal point of view, I'd say I'm 90% confident it'll be back in the calendar next year.
Next year?
It does come down. Yeah, next year I think so. But okay, nothing's certain. Now it comes down to the organisers here putting in the proposal to the FIA this year. So the FIA are waiting for that. They're expecting it. And then it's obviously just has to go through the approval process. And fingers crossed, come August, September this year, we should know if we've got a rally here next year.
Oh, well, listen, you know, what made my morning clearly was seeing your handsome face on the other side of my webcam. But that news about Rally New Zealand really has. That's the icing on the cake for me this morning. I am off to stuff my face with a big Scottish breakfast on that news. Wonderful. Well, that's great stuff.
You can come down this year as well, though, because the weekend after Rally Australia this year, they have the two-day practice, if you like, Rally New Zealand. So you only got to spend an extra week down here and you can come to New Zealand.
I need no excuse at all to spend an extra week or two in your part of the world, Hayden Paddon. That is now very firmly in my diary for the end of the year. Hayden, listen, fantastic. Thank you so much for giving up your time in the Paddon kitchen the Paddon kitchen table this evening. It's always a total delight to talk to you. Good luck with Rally Argentina. We will watch with interest and we'll catch up with you some point after Argentina. Hayden, thank you very much.
Perfect. Thanks so much.